So, in this video, I'm making Requiem, as wielded by Siegfried in the game Soul Calibur. The customer has requested it to be made the same height he is. He's 6'2". It's a very wide, heavy blade, so even by my usual standards, this one's going to be monstrous. Big.
So the correct thing to do when you come across a baby bird in the wild is just leave it there. It's fine. Its parents are probably nearby. But let's say a guy gives your in-laws two baby birds and can't remember or refuses to disclose where he got them, then hand-feeding them... Hold on a second, I'm probably doing this wrong. There we go. Worm in the mouth. Swallow the worm. Good birdie. Good birdie. Mealworm. Swallow him. Swallow him. Good birdie.
This pipe section is crazy. And always, because it doesn't look as crazy on paper, but then when you start to, you know, it always turns out that it is actually that crazy. So I have to bring this guy down. I have to taper this guy. 64. Would I cut off an extra section? This has to be 64, but if I cut it bigger, it'll be easier for me to... Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. Make it 100. Mark the target area, and then if something goes wrong, I have some leeway to cut it left or right of the actual target area, because I'm going to be doing this my usual way with the angle grinder in the lathe chuck on the drill. The cone is a little bit uneven, but it's way better than I thought it was going to be. The way it was vibrating and jumping around in the lathe, I thought it'd be awful. But yeah, I'm going to give it another buzz now that it's cut off. Smooth out that small cleanup I did. There was one side where it was a little bit that I took in, so hopefully that'll be easy enough to fix. Now, have we made enough cone? Oh, very nearly. It has to come up a little bit. There we go. Two and a half. The entire length of this guy is 2.89. I have to weld around the end here when it gets put into the handle. So it's debatable how much of this nice version will survive. I could clean it up a little bit more. I could leave it till after the welding. Okay. There you go. Eat it. We'll get some more.
Well, yeah, you can do that.
There you go.
If we get more...
It's in your mouth, swallow it.
We could get a bigger truck.
And so forth and so on. Oh man, so this bit up here is taken down to roughly the 1.5 blip that it needs to be, and that part is obviously still the 2, but this part in the middle, can you see that stripe in the middle, that part I took down. I took one of the smaller grinders and took this bit in the middle down to the 1.75, so you know, 1.75 half, because it's like an even, supposedly even taper. So that's what I'm doing, standing here forever grinding the side of this thing till that line disappears, and obviously that this looks like a relatively smooth swoop. There's no chance of it being an actual smooth swoop. I'll probably take this down and then realize there's not enough material out here and then have to take that down more. Still though, lots of stuff. This is taking a long time. The inside of these guys is slightly smaller, so I have to take this guy down quite a bit just so that these pieces will fit on. The average historical sword weighs in between 3 and 5 pounds. My gut plate is 3.5 pounds. Can I pick this guy up without burning myself? Three and a half. This is... Oh, come on, behave. There we go. 21. 21 minus 3.5 is 17 and a half. Still can't touch that, it's too hot. But the handle here is 17 and a half pounds. Yep. Hot, hot, hot.
Open your mouth, I'll give you a worm. There you go. Take it, take it, take it, take it. There you go, good bird. Such a good bird. Did that go in? No. Stop dropping them, guys!
I'm gonna have to take him out of the box to feed him because he's not cooperating. This stuff will probably just rub off with the, yep. Feels slimy and gross. How does it respond to being clamped? Because if it can be clamped in position, that's all I really need. If it's bent enough that it can be... Ah yeah, that'll do. Let's sit here and hit him, but that was so much water. The wells here cracked, but the piece didn't move. It didn't lift up off the plate, so that's good. I can hear it creaking. I want it to be cold, cold before I unclamp it. Now, what happens when I unlock this gap? Not much of anything. It's what we wanted. That one's holding position by itself, which is great. Gave her a little bit of a hop when I did that. So in the end, it would need to be squished in the middle. That's weird, it's touching at the two ends, but the middle could do with a bit more of a seam too. Would it clamp down? If it can be clamped down, it's not so bad. There's like a millimeter gap in the middle. Ah, yeah. The clamp's easy enough, it won't be too hard to brutalize into the correct shape before I weld everything together. That was much better than the floating around, floating above the thing. You really need to anchor yourself to do a good TIG weld. And this TIG finger thing seemed to work just great. I'm just wearing it on my bare finger, which I'm sure you're not even supposed to do. And I was able to use the edge of the material as a guide. I managed to tack this other bit just so that it's lined up edge to edge by squishing it this way. But now, can I get rid of this gap by squishing it this way? Pop it out of here. With curved and rounded surfaces, so it's hard to grab them. This inside edge gets the guard plate put on top, and you don't really see it. You don't see this inside edge. This outside edge butts up against, nice and neat against the guard pieces of this, the flat top plate that extrude. But this inside edge, you don't see it at all. It'll have a bunch of welds. It means I could weld these two plates on and not worry about them damaging the look of it. And then hopefully if you put it in here like this and clamp it, I can get that space to close. What? Like so. And now I can weld in here. And then the other hope is the heat of doing that will convince the thing to stay in that position. Is that the first time I've done a vertical weld with the TIG welder? It might be. The vertical welds are just trickier, but with the TIG welder it didn't seem trickier. Maybe it's a vertical arc weld that was the... I remember sub-vertical weld being a nightmare when I was learning how to weld. Anyway, then when I unlock this... everything, hopefully, is nice and polite and I don't hear any catastrophic snapping noises. At least in the viewfinder, it looks like you can indeed see the rainbow. It's just one rainbow though. It's not a double rainbow, let's say. So what I'm doing here is trying to just make sure that nothing on the inside edge would stop this plate I'm going to bend into here touching the outside edge. Might give it a little bit more, but I think it's pretty much there. The idea here is I can loosen this guy off and these clamps will keep it in position. So then the teeth reset, and then when I squish, and now the teeth are pretty much done. So I can re-tighten these guys. Now if I loosen it off, what happens? Okay, and now I tighten it again. Oh, we might have gotten to the end of what the squishing can do. So now I'll get out the heat. It didn't take much heat at all to convince it to just collapse into the right position. If I turn off the heat, stopped. It was doing all sorts of weird creaking and groaning, but I'm just going to leave it there till it cools down and then unclamp it. The outside edge was different once it was actually, like, if you line up tip and it's flat across the top, it was sticking out more on this side and this side than this side, so I decided to trim the whole thing back so it's like a quarter inch proud around the edge, which is probably all it needs anyway. I was slightly worried about the roundy bit for the end, but even trimmed back it seems to fit on there okay. Actually this goes on the other, it goes on the other way. This will be shaved to fit there better, or there, or wherever, halfway. I know that your squawkings are lies because I just fed you. I fed you until you started spitting it out. But you just like it. It's a game. Isn't it a fun game? Wait for the food and then spit the food out again. I fed you so much, you're my fat little bird. But I know that all of your squawkings and complainings are lies. As well, it's welded here on the inside. Look, how do I? There we go. It's welded on the inside with the MIG welder. I had to extend the MIG welder out a lot to. It was tricky. Like, I felt like the wire was like way too much extended for actually getting that weld. But it seemed to work. And maybe because it was an enclosed space, it didn't seem too gassy or bubbly. Like, it was a little bit gassy and bubbly, but not awful. Now to do this other side. That's all the marks taken out of this guy. I can't remember the order of the clips. Eben did one side and I did the other. I finished off this side that Eben started. So that's 80 grit, and then I'll hand take it down to 100. But as you can see, all the grinder and hammer blows and stuff are gone. The ends here look tapered, like they have a bevel on the end. So I'm going to do that. I take it down to not all the way to the middle, because that would start eating into the weld in maybe strange ways. Maybe a quarter inch in the middle, maybe 3/16 in the middle. Shivering, so I moved him closer to the heat lamp, and he keeps doing this funny thing where he droops like he's going to fall asleep. The other one is down in there. Can you see? And he seems to be doing, he or she, the other one is bigger and seems to be doing just fine. But that little guy seemed cold. Did you wake up because I coughed? Droop. Wake. Droop. Droop. Wake. I'm going to check on him now. I just wanted to warm him up a bit.
Got these guys. Leaves. They're a standard gate part, but I noticed the part on the guard of Requiem was with a little bit of modification. These guys are almost a perfect match for it. So they need to flatten them, curve them, chop them a bit, stick a few of them together, and hopefully I'll be able to make these look like the thing. This will match the curve of the plate that they have to actually be joined to. Because this is the same plate I curved the big one around. I'm using a block of wood to do the squishing, because I don't want to lose this surface detail. So each one of these has to be trimmed a little bit to fit into that pattern I made based on the texture from the video game. So it's amazing these things are as close as they were, but they do need to be mutilated a little bit to be exact matches. I'm getting great mileage out of this plate that I bent for curving the guard plates around. I chopped it in two and I've drilled holes on the back, and hopefully I'm going to try and zap some welds in there to join this decorative piece together the way it's supposed to be. Now the hole is kind of deep and the piece is kind of small, so let's see, can I zap it without ruining everything? Now hopefully that's enough, that when I undo these clamps that will have behaved. Let's see. So now I might weld it a little bit more off the thing, but just that was to lock it into the correct position so that it doesn't move on me.
Worms for the birdies. on my head is impatient. So I always feed the slightly smaller one first. Nom nom nom. Starlings are a highly invasive species. They've even invasived my house. This isn't my house, but you get the idea. What's the best way to do this? I'd love to drill through and weld them from the back. Would I be able to get the welder in here? So what I've done here is dog ground out slopes into each of these holes from the back, so that when I'm joining these guys onto the surface, because this material is so thick, I'm just worried that I'm not going to be able to get a nice neat plug weld. Like, these are the easiest ones to get if I hadn't done a slope, but these ones up here, there's just very little space for the cup to go. So hopefully this will work. Side one joined on. Getting the heat marks out of these areas might be difficult. So that's what it looks like when it's cleaned up. I have to do this one now.
There we go.
Okay, ready? Who wants one of these skull bugs, ready? Boom. There it is. They're in there.
They're in the tray. Go in the tray.
It's like Tron. They just run around in straight lines until they hit a wall.
Nom, nom, nom.
Eat the ones in the tray. Eat the ones in the tray.
Go, 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 go. There you go. Good boy.
Fill some more ants.
Boy, girl, whatever. Nom, nom, nom.
Yep.
There you go. Nom, nom, nom.
Yeah. What about those?
You're a big bird now. Oh, wait, off he goes. This is an old candle-y stand, garden candle stand thing that Evan laboriously cleaned up to make the rings on the sword. How did it feel doing that, Evan?
A little tedious, but, you know, not bad. They were like, oh, 3 minutes? We'll watch that one instead.
Perfect. See the way it was hot enough to... It was glowing, but it wasn't like... Blah. See the way there's none of that, like... cruddy scale stuff on the surface.
Yeah.
That's like the perfect temperature. It's easier to get with the smaller stuff, with the big giant stuff. Because there's so much material in the big giant stuff compared to the surface.
Yeah.
You can't avoid doing that. But with the little stuff, you can heat something to bend it perfectly, not create a mess of scale on the surface.
Kill.
Damn, good bird. Ah, you dropped it. Can you get that big fly? What about this little gnat? Look at that little gnat.
Go down.
Damn, nom, nom. The mic filming this doesn't know whether this is going to work or not. But I want to sand the inside of this guy. So I want to make a wooden block and then try to, I'm going to have to cut this down, get the wooden block in underneath here by, man, I'm going to have to chop it like very thin this away in order to get it in.
So I drilled and tapped two holes because I was worried about this guy getting sucked back into here and cracking and breaking. So this is the idea. That is for sure tight, yeah. I've had pieces of metal slide into this space, but usually from the other side. I don't know, it could be an awful nightmare if it slides underneath the belt and around. Let's see, does that work? So these welds on here are like super crappy because I wanted to do the littlest weld that would actually hold the, like, I turned the welder down till it could just barely weld this because I didn't want to wreck the curve with heat, because I was worried that if I zapped it at my usual full blast, it would cause the plate to bend, and I don't want to bend this plate. As it is, just the heat from cleaning it might bend it, but hopefully not so much that I can't just squish it back into position with clamps. But anyway. That didn't take too long. It's a good start. I got rid of all the all the dings in it from bending it. We're gonna do this. I'm a mama bird.
Genetically engineering humans so that wacky political schemes don't just always turn into dictatorships.
Well, and we were talking about game stuff too. If you're designing a game and making the mechanics for how everything works in it, that's sort of like making laws for a country. And if that game is unbalanced in any particular way, you end up with a player that can exploit that and become ridiculously powerful and sort of break the game.
Yeah.
So that might be similar to having any kind of laws that are too extreme in one way, in one direction or the other. And only a very balanced system of laws has any chance of not turning into a dictatorship.
But here's the thing, right? What do you use as your criterion for being balanced? Like,
no clue. No clue.
Yeah, like, because the reason, like, capitalism and stuff seems to work so well is because it's just human greed codified, you know? Yeah. Like, it's just, we just made a rule book around, like, the basic human greed. That's the natural fallacy, is, like, falling back on, well, see, capitalism works great because of human greed, therefore capitalism must be correct, or something.
Yeah, and it's not always.
But this is what I'm saying, is if you could change... Oh yeah, it'd be super dangerous, but if you could start to edit the human... But like, if you edited the greed out, like, then you get into all sorts of things, like if you remove the human striding. Like, humans were not designed by anything. It might be just possible that you need to alter the humans in order to get them to live in giant mega-societies.
Yeah,
like it mightn't be possible using any system at all to get humans to live in giant mega societies.
Yeah.
Now this is the big plate, so. Oh, no, careful! You don't spill. Slash it out the side. All the scale is already off the other side of this.
Okay.
This is just to see, did it actually come off this side, or was it too cold? Oh wow, the big plate is disrupting the... God damn it. I wonder if we... silly, but we could wash it off, dry it off, cut it out, and then put it back in the soup. You know, we could cut out the shape. And then put it back in the soup, but that seems kind of silly.
That's not bad looking for the rest of it. Come on.
Maybe.
During the winter, I sometimes have to give it encouragement with a steel wire brush and a drill.
Yeah.
And what did you do just there?
Drew the outline of this blade.
So that we can spend time angling. Ed, the annoying thing about this one is almost simple enough that I could have just done it by measurements, like I did the Dragon Slayer. But I've said the headline. This side of the blade is actually a very shallow curve. It's not a straight. Can we see it if we go down, dip down? No, not even. But it's so that was annoying, is that it wasn't just a straight line. Because if it was just a straight line, no, you can't really see it. You'd have to get the entire thing. Big flat piece there. You can see the curve, but oh my god, it's so subtle. Like, it won't be a problem for the angle grinder, but it would be a problem for trying to mark this guy out just through measurements. So one of the birdies went missing last night. They had been getting too big for the aquarium thing, so they were sleeping up there last night instead of the aviary. They seemed to enjoy sleeping up in a roosty thing way high up, more than sleeping in that cage. And since they'd been safe every other night in here, in the open top aquarium, I thought they would continue to be safe, but that was wrong. There's no signs of carnage or nothing, no feathers, no blood, just a missing bird. So, you know, he may have gotten out and been just enjoying freedom, but I suspect something snatched him. So, for the moment, we're just going to move you a little closer to home and keep a more tight eye on you till you're more independent. For the inner perimeter of the sword, it has this raised lip thing. It's almost straight lines. The outside has a slight curve, but the inside was straight. So I could just do this one by measurement. I'm just using the printout as a sanity check. Evan, what are you doing?
Working on getting some holes drilled along this piece. These are just the measurements for those holes.
And why are you drilling holes? What's it for?
Because this thing is going to end up getting welded to this thing that already looks like a sword, is going to get welded to the flat of the actual sword.
Yeah. Oh, whoop, there we go.
This one here I didn't spot.
So using the marks on the surface, I can draw a line, and that marks where this frame thing has to go.
So that's the idea. To cut a slot in, where's the plate gone? Am I sitting on it? Where'd I put that plate? It's very hard to mark precisely where to put the slot in this curved surface. So this is my best attempt at doing it. Originally I was going to cut this apart, just cut it in half, well not half, like cut a quarter inch slice and then fill in two pieces. But because of the curve of this guy, it'll just be so much easier to do cleanup if I can just slide this onto the back of the blade here. Crink, and then weld it from in underneath where no one sees, like inside of the guard. So that's what we're at. I need to clamp it more, squish it here. That's going to be long and boring, going squish, zap, zap, squish, zap, zap. So I'm going to turn the camera off for that and check in when it's done. So it needs some cleanup, obviously, on the top of the plate. Annoyingly, a little bit of spatter came through here, so we're going to have to polish that off. Did it melt the edge? It didn't melt the edge. But it's, I wasn't expecting there to be any spatter. There's little bits of stuff in the groove. From underneath, it's very messy. Because it's the MIG welder, the zap, zap, zap. I don't know, can you see it in there? Turned up the 250 amps. Just so you can see the heat bleeding through in certain spots. But yeah, that's it positioned. I had to argue with it a lot to squish it. These, you know, like I centered it here in the center. And then these points needed a little bit of encouragement. So I'm not exactly sure how that's affected the slot. It would be disastrous if the slot was no longer straight across, but we'll see. No, you bastard. Oh my god! Stop! There we go. So a little fooster in the side. That's a relatively amazing fit, if I do say so myself. Focus. It's not cooperating. At the back, it'll have to be propped up and welded in, because this is probably drooping a bit. Can I lift this guy up? You see the movement on it? So it'll have to be moved up. I might put a wedge in here that's like the halfway and the halfway. The other plate gets welded on the back. It'll have a bunch of holes drilled in it so that it's joined onto the actual blade itself. But that's the idea. Get wedges in there to hold it at the right height, whatever it is. Oh, he's on my head. What do you think of the bird on my head? Can we put you back into the... No, not my fingers. We were trying to get you to dig around in these stones looking for food. Dig, dig, dig. Dig for those bugs.
Yeah, dig. Go get him, birdie.
What do you think, dog? What do you think of the birdie?
I want to eat it.
Yeah, no.
I want to eat it so much. Why won't you give it in a... Give me to it in my bowl?
Just a very, very morbid. You're a morbid child.
Why? I was just worshiping the dog.
I know. Go look in the rocks. Go look in the dirt. Are you still... Ah! You think I should just feed you, yeah? Is the doggy jealous? Doggy jealous of Brady. What do you think, doggy? Oh, he's up on my shoulder now. It's okay, dog. It's okay. And now he's up on my head. Again. Whoa. Oh, it was on the head. I decided to clean this plate before joining the frames on because I thought it would be easier, but it means I've lost all my marks and I'll have to mark it again. Where's my sanding block gone? Yeah, I'm good. Where was the other one of this clamp? Huh, that's interesting. I want to double check that's real or is it a measuring issue. If instead of going to the edges, which I think I might have ground a little bit freehand, if we go along this edge and we go here and we take this measurement, we go here, we go this measurement. No, that is right. huh, this line marked here wasn't very good. So then we do that. And then double check that this guy still fits. Aha, and this is why we double check it. God damn it, I have to take it off again because I don't know, can you see that line from where you are there? But this one, take off more material. What about this side? This one is close enough. Time to unclamp everything and get ready to grind a tiny sliver off. Bird, bird, bird. Good bird. You're getting very good at the flying, bird. Whoa, on my head again. And off he goes. Oh, I have to go see where he went now. So that's it clamped into position, ready to weld. If I weld the ends, I'm going to get this guy off here. But if I weld the ends, then I can use a straight edge because these guys are wibbly wobbly. To position them, and then, oh boy, it's going to be a big job. I made up all these little bits. I don't know, can you see them in the bottom of the bucket? To throw in the bottoms of the holes so that I don't have to try and get the electrode and the rod in there. So I had this guy for chopping up the little bits, and it was while I was doing this and I was curious about, like, how many welds is this? How many of those little bits do I need? And so I counted up the holes and it was 67 holes per frame. And whoa boy, because that's like, that's 134 plug welds, 134 of these little guys. I have to do 134 without burning out the edge. It's going to be quite the job. Anyway, better get started. In there, because like I've mentioned, this outer edge is slightly curved, so I can't just do measurements and push it and get this thing into place. And there was a big thing up here where this edge was not cooperating. This other side seems to be better, but this thing here is really, it's like the angle that sprung out during the heat of cutting it. But anyway, I managed to brutalize it into position and get the straight edge in there. So I'm going to do these, there's one of these two welds here, but that's the plan, is to try and use the straight edge and kind of space out where I'm welding so that I don't put too much heat in one spot. That's the last of the welds. Done awfully good at doing plug welds.
the last day and a half. Oh, man.
Yeah, no, I had the technique down. They're perfect. I'd cut all these little bits for dropping in the holes, but I think I miscounted them. I had loads extra. And then I found out you leave a little pile on top of the... You do the initial zap to get a good join at the bottom of the hole. But then if you just leave three other little bits kind of on top of the hole, like a little tiny log pile, and go zap, that had a higher... That would seem to result in a neater weld than the coming in from the side and trying to fill it in with the rod. I think because you're trying to fill it in a hole, into a hole, it sometimes behaved oddly, like the puddle would all of a sudden jump to the electrode and you'd be like, oh! But if you come directly from above and zap a pile that was already there, it seemed to work perfectly. Oh, man. Yeah, I'm going to grind that in the morning. Now, the next thing to see is how badly is it warped if it's there was lots of heat on the other side, which bananaed it this way, and then the idea was a weld at this side, and it bananas at this. Like, I use loads of clamps, but it's still, like, that's a lot of welding, you know? So, bloop, and then hopefully weld at this side, and it goes bloop, and then even out to straight. That would be in a perfect world, but I'll have to see tomorrow what actually happened. So, the birdie was sitting up on that ledge, and I wasn't sure where the birdie had gone, and I was freaking out that maybe certain felines had done a mischief when I heard a little scritch scritching. And it turns out we're up there, but we're going to get you out of there because I don't want bird poop all over that stuff. No. Problem when you sand like this to get it back to the same texture as this is the wells, being a slightly different material, they start to peek out. Normally when I get a big plate, straightening it is the very first thing I do. But because I knew I was welding these frames on, I decided to wait until I had done that, because I knew the heat from doing it was bound to do something to the blade. I wish I had tracked actually what was going on, because like, it would be interesting to know whether it had changed the initial warp on the blade, or if it had put a new warp in, or if it had exaggerated the existing warp, made the existing warp opposite. But instead, I know it has to be bent this way now. So it'll be interesting to see, do the welds and everything survive that? That was actually a little bit easier than it is normally, not harder. So my guess is the welding the frames on damaged the temper of the hardox a little bit. It's less elastic than it used to be. I don't know, does that matter on a gigantuan sword? It would matter more on a little sword.
because the amount of force required to bend it would be so much smaller than that. Being elastic is very important for a normal size sword, so who knows? What, you want me to come out? The birds, I'm just filming the bird having a bath in the sink. So that's this guy positioned with some minor fiddling. There's little gaps here that weren't there before so that it can be exactly to the top, like that it's actually like each point on the side measures equidistant to the point on the top. So I'm gonna weld these little guys in here. And get a weld in here and here and here and here, and then that's that joined, and I can start thinking about the next thing, the base plate. And I'll try to get a weld up in here and here, but I'm slightly worried about the spatter, but we'll see what we can do. A breather. The mask doesn't fit quite right without it. Ow. Did that sting much? Okay, we're in business. The inside of this guy, I could not get the regular head to reach in. None of the heads I had lying around were able to get in there. I wanted to weld this plate to the surface, so I made this super janky thing out of a piece of copper pipe. Can I get it to focus? There we go. Piece of copper pipe wrapped in tape. I have replacements for all the parts inside. The thing I was worried about was the threads here. That would be the main one that I wouldn't be able to replace. There's my super ghetto super narrow welding head. There's a regular one for comparison. You up on the roof of the house? I can't get you up there. If you want me to feed you, you have to fly down. Bird, bird, bird. Good bird. Whoa. That's acceptable. So what I've done here is I welded a threaded piece in here and then put a nut on. I drilled a bunch of holes, especially around here. This is actually probably the only important part, and these parts are just for holding this base plate on. But this part is where the business welds will be. So this is in the middle. But now, as you can see, this side of it basically follows the curve, but this side moves away. And if I had a way to clamp it so that I could measure left and right, was left and right the same?
before I go welding anything here, that's what I'm working on now, is trying to figure out how I'm going to do that. I welded on a threaded piece and a bolt in here, and the idea is I'll be able to undo that. Where's the thing now? There it is. I'll be able to undo that now, but having that piece there allowed me to clamp this and position it so that everything was equal on every side. It's the best of my ability, but it is 3 o'clock in the morning-ish, so my brain is not working at 100% capacity. So I should be able to undo this. And then looking from above, there should be no gap. Still no gap, good. So then this gets welded in those holes, and hopefully the heat from that will relax the plate, combined with these clamps, will relax the plate into the position it's supposed to be. I may wait till tomorrow morning to weld it, because my brain is not braining properly at the moment. Gollum, get down from the sink.
What? Wait, what did you call me? What did you call me?
Gollum.
What the heck is that?
So that's the important welds done. I got a fill on top of those now to bring them up to the same level as the base plate. But those are, you know, it took quite a bit of material to convince everything to join to everything in a way I wanted. You know, because it's just tricky, like welding from the side, trying to make sure like that it was mission critical that the things like fuse, because if I just managed to go bluff over the surface without it joining to the stuff underneath, that's pointless. So that's what hot, sweaty work. Whew. So what I did here was shield everything off with soot from the oxyacetylene, and then do a lot of MIG welding. The soot works as an anti-spatter, like everything there is too hot to touch, but it should just wipe off. Because it doesn't, the whole point of it is it doesn't interact with the weld, that you can just take it off with your finger. And I'm going to wait till that cools off to unclamp it and then start cleaning stuff up. That's just the 50 grit. I'm going to go down now to the 80 grit and stuff.
Got a mosquito out of the air. He's saving you from mosquitoes.
My two router sprays here. Taking the vernier calipers, and then I was able to mark the middle point on the back here, so there's like a point that's actually on the surface 25 millimeters in. A little magnet to see how it tops. This is nice and flight. Measure back. 1619. 1619. Side. This one's trickier. It's
the edge of this guy is beveled, but I can see the edge. So it looks like 175. This also looks like 170.5. So that handle is positioned. Oh, the height. This is suspended 1.25 inches because of this guy on the other side. That's how high this needed to be up. And then the difference between the blade and the handle, this is an additional 22 millimeters up, which I got by stacking a bunch of it's a little jack thing, the base of a mill jack. I don't know what you call it, the little things for adjusting heights that screw into each other, but it was just the base of one plus a little aluminum piece, and that gets me the 22 millimeters on top of the 1.25 inches pieces. And so everything lines up. I slid the collar up there to see, like, the main thing is when you slide the collar up there, is the collar roughly the same distance away from both sides of the edge? And as best as I could tell, it was. So you can tell whether or not the handle is more or less centered, which it is. So I think that guy's ready to weld up. Ebon ground a bevel, you can see, and then that bevel will connect, be contiguous with the weld that's in there already. You know, like I said, this, by the time I was finished welding this, this entire area in here was just made out of weld. Make sure the tail is left and right correctly, but this position is locked in place now. How will this move as I unclamp it? I didn't see any movement. Now, Ebon, you can help me flip this guy over. Fuse on the board was tripped, but then when I reset it, the TIG welder didn't come back on. So that means I gotta finish this guy off with the MIG welder, which is not bad. It just means I have to take extra. It's good that I got in those early initial things. It makes welding the collar on a little more complicated, but it shouldn't be too bad for this. Go wait for that to cool off before I unclamp everything. Gonna zap through the holes and then grind back.
That's the last of the welding on this guy. And then there's the other... the light's not quite right, but the other join is in there. And then here on the other side, that's the... And now the only thing left now is to darken this middle part of the blade. What are you doing in there? Now we're darkening the middle using gun blue. I'm doing this upside down because I want to minimize the chance of gun blue seeping in underneath the guard plate, because that will make life difficult. Also, the water I have to wash the gun blue off with. Dried acetone WD-40. The reason I haven't done these edges, you can see parts with the black oxide. Can you imagine a stripe extending from here back to here? Basically along the lines of the tape I used to mask it. Because this stuff is pernicious in its ability to, you know, it's a liquid, it will seep through anything. But it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. I didn't have to do that much cleanup, and most of the cleanup was down here because of gravity. Which is what I wanted, because up here there's just more stuff. It would have been harder to clean up that area. So now the last thing to do is to just finish off the edge to polish it. So I might come out tonight and do that. And then, is that more finger marks? The WD-40, the finger marks, you know. And it's a big sword, so it's very hard to not get finger marks on it somewhere, you know? This little part has to be done by hand before I do this part with the drum, because the drum won't be able to get all the way up into here. Still something there I have to take out. So a couple of days ago, I got up in the morning, I get Bird out of his aviary and gave him breakfast, and he flew off into the trees, which is pretty much what had been happening, was our usual pattern. The unusual part is he didn't reappear. He's gone now. I haven't seen him in days. Hopefully he's an adult bird now, flapping around, totally independent. But yeah, I've really no way of knowing. I looked on the internet, sometimes they do that, they just decide, hey, I'm an adult now, and they're gone. But yeah, I have no way of telling.
Is your end? I was gonna ask, is your end heavier, but you can't tell.
Yeah. It probably is. With all this apparatus over here.
Alright, so this is... Evan, get out of the camera frame. Yeah. Don't stand in the front of the camera. It's day one, that's the lesson, Evan. Don't stand in front of the camera. We weighed this guy, it's 75 pounds. 190 centimeters. Can a human lift it up? Oh, Jesus! Evan, look behind the camera. Can you see the whole lot of the sword, or do I have to walk backwards?
You have to walk backwards. There you go. Now it's in the shot.
75 pounds of sword! It's very heavy! 190 centimeters!
I should try smashing something with it. So that's Requiem finally finished. It took a lot longer to make than I thought it was going to make, but I think it came out pretty good. Side note, I was looking at my numbers and 75% of my viewers aren't subscribers, which seems crazy to me because I would have thought that making giant swords was a fairly niche thing. So, I don't know, hit subscribe maybe. I'm so close to getting 1 million subscribers, guys. So close.